Assalamu alaikum, you're watching Views and News, and I'm Faisal Rahman, live from our Islamabad studios. Today we'll be talking about the economy of Pakistan. Now, since it's a huge subject, so we'll try to touch upon as many areas as possible. If you remember, Prime Minister has given certain proposals to the textile sector yesterday. Whenever we talk about exports, unfortunately for the last couple of years, we've been missing our targets regarding the exports. And whenever you talk about exports, obviously you need to have a certain amount exported so that the import, if it's there, so that the when you talk about the difference between the two, that is the deficit, that needs to be reduced. Your imports, at least 6 months of import should be there as far as your forex reserve is concerned. So these are a couple of very interesting dynamics you need to understand. And then we talk about the collection of tax. Now, that is the money available for the government to spend on various projects, whether they are the development projects or they are the debt servicing or otherwise. So in that particular case, you need to again consider that we are always short. Then we have to borrow money from various financial institutions or even from the State Bank of Pakistan. That's the internal borrowing as well as the external. That has significantly gone up. Then you talk about the government expenditure. That needs to be reduced. You talk about tax to GDP ratio. That needs to grow and get into double figures. And at least it should be around 14 to 16% considering a country like Pakistan. I'm talking about the minimum. And then you need to talk about also that factor, that is the tax base, that how many people are actually paying taxes. Is it only the people who are working, or whether they're in the private sector or the public sector? What about the huge number of people who are related to the agriculture sector or services sector for that matter? And what is the level of transparency in that regard? Then we talk about the gray area of economy. Unfortunately, that is as big as your real economy, and that is around $285 billion. There was this report in a very known magazine, Economist. It says that the Pakistani GDP growth, according to them, it is 5.3%, ahead of 4% growth of Israel. Now, one has to understand that 5% growth of Pakistan as compared to another country with a much larger GDP, even if that is 1%, so that is a different equation to see. And then when you talk about the Muslim countries, they have considered Pakistan as one of the best in terms of GDP growth. Primarily, it seems that because of the oil prices, most of these oil producing countries, since the prices of the oil, they have gone down. So obviously, as far as their exports are concerned, they are in problem. They are in trouble. Then you talk about the Indian GDP, that's around 7.5%, Vietnam 6.6, China 6.4. For the first time, they've gone down so much in the last almost 50 years. Otherwise, they were always hovering around 11%, 12% throughout, whether it's recession in USA or not. Then the Prime Minister has also taken certain initiatives. One was regarding the trade enhancement initiative. We'll be talking about that in detail. That certain areas were neglected in the past, what needs to be done. And then whenever they're geared up, unfortunately, the problem of energy comes in. And then not only about the availability of electricity, I'm talking about the certain price per unit. Now, that is really important when you talk about doing the cost of doing business. That seems to be pretty high in Pakistan. And unfortunately, we're losing our market share in various sectors. You talk about Sri Lanka. You talk about Bangladesh, you talk about Turkey, you talk about Cambodia, and even so many other countries, they are taking that market share, even India for that matter. So a lot needs to be done, as it is believed that whenever you lose a customer or a client for that matter, you need to spend almost 8 times more money in order to retain him back. So we are already losing. We couldn't capitalize even when we were given that GSP plus status. Why was that so? So there are a couple of very interesting areas to look at. Then you look at the overall agriculture sector. And when you look at the budget, there was this negative growth in the agriculture sector. You talk about large-scale manufacturing. We've hardly seen any significant jump in that side also. When you talk about, for that matter, the services sector, that has really shown a very significant growth. But is that the only area we need to focus? When you talk about remittances, we are very lucky. We're getting a lot of remittances. They have actually surpassed the level of 15 billion. So that gives a lot of support to the overall economy. But is that enough? When you talk about export, that is where the real name of the game is. You talk about the GDP growth. You need to do so much on so many fronts. And law and order is one huge area to look into. You talk about foreign investment, whether it's the FDI or other formats. Is it coming in the right areas, like not in the stock market, though the example yesterday was given that when the Prime Minister took charge almost 3 years ago, the stock market was at 19,000 level. Right now, it is around 49,000, almost doubled, 2.5 times, let's put it this way. Why only stock market? Why not our GDP? It should have been around $600 billion by now. So is that the right parameter to judge the economy of a country? So there are multiple factors. What about the rating agencies? I mean, that's a different ballgame altogether if you go into the details. Then you talk about the flight of capital. A lot of people have moved their businesses. I'm talking about textile for that matter, either to Malaysia or to Sri Lanka or Bangladesh for that matter. What about those people, if we talk about brain drain, who really want to work here, really want to contribute? Unfortunately, they're leaving Pakistan. We can't even convince those who are working abroad to come back and we'll give you some sort of an initiative. That is where the red tape of the bureaucracy comes in, and that is where the problem is. We always have heard about that one window operation, that, you know, come in, we'll sort your issues out. This is the window of opportunity, and you will not be fooled around anymore. But unfortunately, people come, they get disgusted, and they go back. This is another reality one has to look into. But at the end of the day, Pakistan is our country. And at the end of the day, again, it's all about the economy. Why everybody supports India on certain issues where they are totally wrong? Because India is a market for them. It's all about money. It's all about the dollar. It's all about the bills. It's all about the strength of your economy. It's about your purchasing power. It's about so many other indexes. We'll be talking about that in detail. We have with us in our studio to talk about that. On my right is Dr. Abid Hassan Saab, known economist. He's no introduction, sir. Thank you very much for being a part of our show. We also have with us Professor Zamir Ahmed Awan Saab. He's an expert on CPEC. As we always say, that CPEC is going to be the game changer. So we'll ask him what exactly CPEC is going to do. Sir, thank you very much. Okay. And we'll be also talking to Miftah Ismael Saab in our program. And we'll also take his point of view since we talk about investment or when we talk about privatization. There's a lot going on that front as well. So first of all, looking at the statement issued by The Economist, it's a known magazine. It has a lot of credibility. It says 5.3% ahead of 4% growth of Israel, and one of the best performing, I would say, country in terms of the GDP growth in the Muslim world. Obviously, was it right when I said that most Muslim countries were dependent on the oil production, and since the prices they've gone down, it has supported us because we were the importers, they were the exporters. So is that the reason, sir, primary reason?
Probably. I mean, although, once again, I'm not sure where Economist got its numbers of 5.3, I think.
It was 4.4, I guess.
Is it 4.4?
Yeah. I mean, according to the documents of Pakistan, sir, I'm talking about the budget book.
Yeah, well, budget is just an estimate. I think most institutions, let's say the World Bank, Asian Bank, IMF, and, you know, independent economists in Pakistan, they're anywhere from 4 to 4.5 is the best estimate, right? So, which is okay. I mean, you know, it's inched up from 3%. It was 2% in the previous government.
2.2, I remember.
You know, it's gone up, inching up. So it's good. I mean, you know, I think in the last 3 years, I mean, there's been a turnaround. I mean, our reserves have gone up. Inflation has come down. Our energy shortages have reduced. So that's the case of glass half full, right? But there's a huge glass half empty as well.
Yep.
I mean, you know, and that's where I think generally what happens is policymakers get complacent by looking at the glass half full, and they forget there's a glass half empty as well. So, for example, our debt levels have gone very high. Our exports are really gone down dramatically. I mean, okay, most countries' exports have gone down as the global economy is growth has slowed down. But Pakistan's decline in exports is far higher, the decline, than, let's say, India or China.
If you compare it with that ratio.
You know, if you compare with India or Bangladesh or China. So, and that's very worrisome. I think we've done, I would say, reasonably okay on tax side. Our tax to GDP has gone up by 1 percentage point, but there is total absence of tax reform. So whether you can sustain, and I'll come to this point, I mean, this whole package that's been given by the Prime Minister and the tax aspects, all that, I mean, very worrisome. And you've pointed out the doing business indicator. Pakistan is in the company of Burundi and Yemen and all that. Yes. You know, I mean, so you may have,
it's
you
not
know,
5%
that.
That's the World Economic Forum's report,
absolutely,
sir.
Right? The competitiveness of this country also has declined. You are now 126th out of 140 countries. India is 55th. Not that 55th is
so
any
I've
better
heard they're
than...
I've heard they're around 37 at the moment.
Sorry?
37.
India? Yeah, maybe it's improved. So, the whole state-owned enterprises, I mean, those... No reform is taking place. Look at PIA, steel mill, energy sector entities. Their performance have improved because we've kept raising prices. Not because they have very efficient boards or managements or, you know, I mean, billing is better. Again, what is some FDI? You know, in the last, let's say, 4 or 5 years, we have had this FDI of, I don't know, $4-5 billion.
Even less than that, yeah.
Yeah. India has had 100 billion. No, okay, India is much larger economy.
They're also giving a lot of incentives to the NRIs, non-resident Indians.
A subset of FDI is FPI, foreign portfolio investments. Right, which is partly what drives the market a bit, well, stock market. So last 3 years, we have had foreign portfolio investments of $1.5 billion. India has had $30 billion. But this FPI is really footloose. It comes in and goes. Basically, the a foreign
hedging,
investor.
Sir. You make money and you're out.
You're out, exactly. So net portfolio investments are close to zero. So you have $1 billion coming in, $800 million going out. So overall, I think I would not celebrate. Well, I mean, okay, fine. It makes you feel good, makes the economic managers feel good that this index has gone up from 30,000 or 20,000 to 40,000. What does that mean? We are four people sitting in this room. How many of us, I don't invest in the stock market. You see, in America, maybe 100 million of their population, 150 million people are invested in the stock market. In Pakistan, the value market cap has gone up from 3 trillion to 9 trillion. So forget the index. The value of all the shares are now worth 9 trillion rupees. So they went up from 3 trillion to 9 trillion. So there has been a 6
so
trillion.
Then there are a couple of factors, I think, which are involved. Because, you know, when you talk about the stock market, Dr. Saab, from 19,000 to 49,000.
Yeah, what does the index mean?
What I'm saying is, sir, that... what DG Khan Cement, for that matter, has done, or what Atak Petroleum has done, for that matter, that their share prices have doubled. Have they increased their production? Done something otherwise?
That's what I'm saying. Market cap, which reflects the...
These were the financial institutions' support.
So market cap has gone up by 6 trillion. So somebody's wealth has gone up by 6 trillion, right? Part of that wealth should be captured by the state. After all, the purpose of a stock market, there are several purposes, okay?
If you remember, they tried to introduce that VAT.
It didn't work. It didn't work.
Remember?
Right.
And there were people who were so strong, right. they just went after
the all
Prime
this,
Minister.
The glamour.
Shock of disease at that time.
The glitz and
glamour. And that was 0.1%.
So all this glitz and glamour of the stock market is limited to 50,000, 100,000 people in Karachi, the really super wealthy. It's not a widespread benefit to the economy. Having said that,
it doesn't have a
trickle
down effect on the common man. Yeah.
You see, for example, a major, let's say, purpose of a stock market or a capital market is raising new money. Right? In the last 5 years, we have had new shares issued, new listing, 30 in number, just 30. And we've raised about 100 billion rupees, that's $1 billion, in 5 years. We've raised some new debt issues, companies have issued. So that's also about 25 in number.
Some bonds as well.
Some bonds as well, right? So the thing is, this index, increase in indexes, is a game between the rich. You sell to me, I sell to him, he sells to you. And, you know, a little bit driven by foreign portfolio investors, it's a lot of hype. The transparency, and what you just said, for example, I was looking at numbers from the central bank. The profits of listed companies, total profits of all listed companies, has remained constant in the last 5 years. It was 480 billion in 2013, it's 470 in 2014, 510 billion. So profits of all these 400-500 companies...
They haven't significantly increased.
So you ask yourself, so why is this, you know, so it's a lot of
stock market is pretty tricky because, you know, in stock market, what happens is, sir, that... You know,
the you see, the other thing, let me fasten.
And they are so powerful people sitting in the
That's
Pakistan
the whole
Stock
point.
Exchange in Karachi. They can literally bring the prices down. They'll open a few windows to sell, few other windows will be buying, and then that's how you play around.
Four or five big brokerage homes drive the market.
Actually,
and there has never been in Pakistan anybody who's been penalized or sent to jail or for insider trading. Never.
That's it. That happens, right? Unfortunately, sir. That is the name of the Professor Zamir Ahmed Awan Saab. So your take on the overall economy of Pakistan, since it's a huge subject. So first of all, let's start off from the GDP factor. So your take. Economist says around 5.4%, better than Israel, better than most Muslim states. What have we done that we have achieved this mark so far, sir?
Well, let me say in a little bit detail. I'm researching on CPEC, the impact of CPEC on our economy, overall economy. Mm-hmm. There must be many other factors, oil factors and other factors maybe. But the impact of CPEC is very, very serious and very huge. There was a time when nobody was willing to give us a loan or credit. And now, with the Chinese investment, our reputation has been improved in the international institutions. Now the World Bank, Asian Development Bank, Islamic Development Bank are willing to give us the loans and credits and all type of financial assistance. The impact of CPEC is very, very serious on Pakistan's economy. And we are lucky and we must appreciate and congratulate there are some achievement in overall economy. But our actual potential is much more than that one. We should get much more than that one. We are a nation of 200 million people. We have more potential, and the Chinese assistance is unlimited. Let me also explain about the China. There was a time when China was a backward, poor, and like that. But the China today is a different China. A lot of people in Pakistan, they don't understand the China of today. They still think the China of 80s and 70s and 60s.
It has become the second largest economy, is going to be the largest soon. So that means China is nowhere. Because when I went to China in 2011,
yes,
I was thinking of the same old China, people on bicycles, but I was shocked
yes.
to see.
It is
literally, it's a
second largest economy, emerging power, and the best thing that the China is willing to help Pakistan. The Chinese leadership and the Chinese people, they love Pakistan. They are very sincere with Pakistan. It is up to us how we perceive it, how we negotiate with them. It is our duty to increase our capability and communicate with the Chinese, negotiate in best interest of the nation, best interest of the country. This is our responsibility. But this is really a huge opportunity for us.
All right. So if you allow me, sir, we've been joined in by Miftah Ismael Saab, the chairman of BOI. Assalamu alaikum, Miftah Saab.
Assalam.
Sir, thank you very much for taking out your time. Sir, talking about the incentives the Prime Minister has given to the textile sector in particular and in general in order to boost the exports, because unfortunately, sir, we have seen negative growth in the agriculture sector. We haven't seen a greater a positive index as far as the manufacturing sector is concerned. Yes, we have seen something going on pretty well as far as the services are concerned. Your take, first of all, sir. Economist says that the growth is around 5.3% ahead of Israel, which was 4%, and better than most Muslim states. First of all, let's start off from there, sir. The statement issued by the magazine Economist about our GDP.
Now, we have actually planned for 5.5% increase in growth this year. Initially, there was a lot of skepticism, including from our own, critics in Pakistan, economists and political parties. But now I think there's a broad-based consensus that the growth will be more than 5, and I think the Economist magazine is talking about 5.3% growth. We've actually talked about 5.5, and given the numbers that are coming in for agricultural products produced, and given the sugarcane production and cotton production that is expected, I think we will actually be in cross 5.5 and go to 5.7 or 5.8 in terms of the growth. And also, I think given the Prime Minister's package for exports, we will see an upturn in exports in the next 6 months, and that will also boost our GDP growth.
All right. And then talking about the incentives the Prime Minister has given, sir, unfortunately, what we have witnessed in the past is despite giving them incentives, and I'm talking about the textile sector, they haven't been able to perform so well, sir. They had issues like regarding energy, then the price of energy, availability of energy, there was flight of capital, there was brain drain, then shifting of business from Pakistan to other countries like Bangladesh and so on and so forth. But now the Prime Minister is still hopeful, and Mr. Sagdar, the Finance Minister, says that in another, say, 2 to 3 years, we need to hit something like 32 billion to 35 billion. Is that an optimistic approach, or is it an over-optimistic approach, sir?
No, I mean, you have to look at the package size. I mean, previously, packages that we've given have been like 6 billion, 7 billion, 8 billion. This is 180 billion over 18 months. So the package size is so huge. And it's a widespread package, not just in textile, but cutlery, carpets, rugs, surgical instruments, a lot of these products, you know, leather goods, of course, they're all getting incentives. So we expect that there is going to be a huge upturn in exports, and that our exporters will try to regain lost market share from there.
Second point, sir, if you remember when the former governor of Punjab, Sarwar Khan Sahab, Muhammad Sarwar, was there in Pakistan Muslim League, and he made a lot of effort, and then we were given that GSP plus status, if you remember, sir. We couldn't capitalize on that even. So what will we do now in order to do something so productive, so positive, that we can actually increase our exports on almost like 20% increase on a yearly basis, sir?
First of all, I think that it would be unfair to just give the entire credit for that to Governor Sarwar Sahab. He was certainly an important member of the team, but I think that Khurram Dastagi, the Commerce Minister, really led the effort. And there were a lot of other Pakistani who worked on that, including from the Commerce Department. And I think the Prime Minister himself had words with foreign prime ministers, and that, I think, probably made a difference in us getting GSP. That said, we have actually made progress because of the GSP, and we have actually increased our exports to the Eurozone economies in double digits, while the exports to other economies have been falling. But you also please appreciate the fact that when GSP Plus was approved, we were getting 147 rupees to a euro. Today, the euro is less than 120 rupees. So exporters have obviously lost 20 rupees for every euro of exports. And so this duty drawback scheme helps them to regain some of their lost ground.
Sir, dollar is hovering around 108 to 110 rupees a dollar. I remember the finance minister said that we'll keep it well under 100. And I remember at that time it was capped around 98 rupees a dollar. And now there's a significant jump of around 11%. So obviously, sir, something is wrong somewhere. People say that the government is printing a lot of money, and that is primarily the reason for this. Though at the same time, they're trying to control the inflation. They plan to make a growth-oriented policy. So there seems to be some sort of a confusion somewhere, sir. Would you like to throw light on that front? Why is dollar not being stable?
The inflation is 3.72%. So we've actually kept inflation under 4% in the last 2.5 years. I think that there is to be credit given for that. As far as the interbank rates are concerned, that's 104.6 or something in the rupee. And it's been reasonably stable, where every other currency in the region and every other currency in our competing markets has lost value to the U.S. dollar. Pakistani currency, it's essentially held its own against the U.S. dollar. And we appreciate it against the Indian rupee, Bangladesh taka, against the Vietnamese dong, against the Chinese yuan, against the Turkish lira. I mean, every currency you name it, pound, sterling, euros, we've actually gained strength. So I think rupee has been very strengthened over the last few years.
If you look at the oil prices, they have gone down. You look at the gold prices, they have gone down. I mean, when you talk about the commodities, and these are the major commodities. One more thing, sir. What about the government borrowing? Reports also suggest that they have gone up significantly, sir. Whether you talk about the local borrowing from the state bank, or you talk about the borrowing from the other financial institutions.
What I will commit to you is that when we came to government, when the Prime Minister of Pakistan, Mian Nawaz Sharif, was elected to power, the total debt to GDP was about 64.5%. It is still the same today, a little less than that. It's not increased. So you say that our total borrowing has increased
60%,
in relation to our GDP is not true. Yes, in nominal terms, it has gone up. But in terms of its percentage of GDP, our total borrowing remains the same. And we have been able to bring the budget deficit from 8.8% or 8.2% in the first year that we were here, down to this year, inshallah, we are going to be less than 4% or around 4%. I think that's a remarkable achievement to reduce the budget deficit from 8.2% to 4% in the space of 3 years, while at the same time growing the economy by more than 4% in the first year, 4.74% last year, and inshallah, 5.3 and 5.8% next year.
So that means that when you're talking about the budget deficit, that you're also looking at the collection is going to go up and the expenditure at the same time is going to go down. Is that what you mean, sir?
We've increased our budgetary resources. We've increased our revenue, FPI revenue, by 60% over the last 3 years. In a country which has low inflation and historically very little tax collection efficiency, we've increased our budget collections by revenue collection by 60%. I think that's a remarkable number. In terms of expenditures, of course, we can't cut all the expenditures. We need to spend money. When we came, we were giving 1,200 billion rupees to the provinces. Now we're giving 1,900 billion rupees to the provinces. We are spending a lot of money on Zarbe as well. We should. We are spending a lot of money to take care of the most needy in Pakistan through Benazir Income Support Program. We're spending about 125 billion rupees on that. The government has priorities. We are spending about $8 billion or 800 billion rupees on PSDP. That is going to help put electricity generation back on the national grid. So those are important things where government needs to spend money, where we are spending money on infrastructure development projects, on helping the poor. But we have cut down unnecessary expenditures and current expenditures.
Now, Miftah Sahab, last quick comment, sir, since you're the person in charge for the investment side, Board of Investment, you're the chairman. Now, two important points. Number one is that we are not seeing a significant increase in the FDI. Obviously, we do understand that the law and order and so many other, despite the fact that the kind of incentives the government is offering, that will give you assurance about the investment in Pakistan, that is going to be a sovereign guarantee from the government in dollars, that is kind of an insurance you'd be providing. If I'm a foreigner, I want to invest in Pakistan, I don't need a local person, 100% equity could be mine. And then you're telling that you can have a profit ratio, your rate of return, that's around 30-35%. You talk about Coca-Cola, Pepsi or otherwise. Despite those incentives, why are we not able to fetch the kind of investment we could have, sir?
Because capital is very shy, and we have done things in the past which have driven capital away. And also at the same time, you know, to attract foreign investment is very difficult when you have a perception of a law and order issue, when you have perception of other issues. But we have changed the Prime Minister has changed the game really in terms of the law and order in Pakistan. We are now a very secure economy. We are a secure country. We've stabilized our economy. We're growing. And you will see now, in fact, and you are seeing investment coming into Pakistan. We've actually in the last few months, we've actually had a Dutch company spend $500 million in a dairy product company in Pakistan. We've had a Turkish company invest $250 million in an air conditioning company in Pakistan. We've had actually a Korean car company wanting to invest and is coming to Pakistan to build cars in Pakistan. We've had a French car company, first time in our history, coming into Pakistan. So you are seeing those things, but obviously it takes more than a day to set up industries, more than a year to set up industries. But you will see that in a year or two when a lot of investments will come. When all the international agencies give you a higher rating.
Gawa also promised $500 million to invest in Pakistan. So last comment, Miftah Sahab, since you talk, obviously, it's not easy to bring in people, you know, you need to have that conducive environment. But whenever you look at the reports coming from the World Economic Forum, for that matter, they're not that encouraging when it comes to it. When you talk about governance, there are issues. You talk about transparency. Yes, sir, there are issues. These are all realities, unfortunately. The people who are ready, they want to bring money to Pakistan, but unfortunately, they're not. There's a trust deficit, sir. So what exactly is your department doing in that regard, sir? And plus, one more point, sir, stock market. What went so great in Pakistan during the last 3 years that the stock market from 19,000 points has jumped to 49,000 points, sir?
I mean, something must have happened positively, right? When people are actually putting real money in it, and when people are putting their own money in it and buying stocks of Pakistani companies at a higher value than they used to. when the stock market goes from 19,000 to 49,000, this is not some magic. This is hard work by the government of Pakistan. This is stability in the economy. This is people looking at the future outlook of this economy. This is a really good country with a lot of resources. We've not been able to marshal our resources well and utilize these resources well. This is the first time that our government is doing it in the last 3 years. And you will see that 49,000, the market will not stay. There's still a lot of room for the market to grow, and not just the stock market to grow. The valuation of land in Pakistan has gone up. The valuation of factories in Pakistan has gone up. And Pakistan is now at the verge of taking off. And you will see for the next 10, 20 years, Pakistan will be growing, inshallah, in double digits, and we will make serious dents in poverty and bring a lot of employment to our young people. Thank you very much.
Okay, I've been following the stock market since 2000. Since 2000, and at that time, the market was around 1,100 points. So, sir, if you just take that as an indicator for that matter, just multiply that 11 by 49 times, that means that if the stock market at that time was around 110 billion, should have been 49 times more, sir. But didn't happen that way. So do you believe that the stock market is the right indicator when it comes to economy, sir?
People are putting their money. Who am I to second guess? Why should I second guess? Why should I try to become skeptical about my country's success? If the whole world is thinking that Pakistan is one of the best emerging markets in the world, Pakistan is one of the best performing markets in the world, why are the Pakistanis, you know, making faces about this? Why are the Pakistanis not celebrating this? I don't understand this. This is a great thing for Pakistan.
Good luck, sir. Thank you very much. Sir, I think that was a detailed one. I really wanted to get all the info on most of the points. But sir, talk up now. Stock market, they believe that, the world has said that the Pakistani stock market is the most, I think it's one of the best operating market. And though, I mean, you can do an absolute series of shows on that as well. But let's get back to the basics. So one of the points raised by Mr. Miftah was that the investor is shy. Despite whatever incentives we have offered, sir, let's not do any comparison with the Indians. It's a different ballgame altogether. Why can't we even fetch $1 billion a year?
Well, it partly reflects, I think...
Look, things have really improved in our post-Zarbe Azb. Law and order situation is a lot better.
Look, what is the reality of how foreigners perceive Pakistan, right? If we say, and clearly, yes, things have improved. Has tourism gone up? No, right? Let's say, last 5 years.
By the way, how much majority, have you invested in the tourism, sir?
Majority of your embassies here, right?
They're
non-family stations.
Yes.
What does that tell
it's
you?
Kind and of these a hard are area.
Are civil servants. These are not investors. So if civil servants sitting in America or Denmark or UK, if their governments are not comfortable sending their civil servants, imagine the investor. I mean, when they have a choice to go to Turkey or Thailand or Vietnam, clearly things have improved, but they have not improved to an extent where firms like General Motors or, global firms are willing to come here as against going to Vietnam. So one has to, when you say, okay, let's forget India, fine, let's go. After all, India had $100 billion of foreign investment in the last 3 years. And, you know, we had only $9 billion. So the people who invested in India, I mean, we have to figure out a way to attract them here. But so far, we have not really succeeded. And it's partly, I think, law
when
and order.
The CEOs do not come to Karachi or Islamabad for the matter, and they want people to come to Dubai
for the
meetings. That tells the story.
Not CEO. I mean, look at the IMF. All
meetings
are held in Dubai. So you have to ask yourself, I mean, Miftah gets paid for what this spiel he did. The reality is people, foreign investors, foreign institutional institutions are still kind of shy, right? And even those who lend money are shy. I mean, IMF is a lender, it's not an investor. Yeah. Even they are shy to come here. But having said that, I think we all want, as Pakistanis, mm-hmm. that our country is seen as a great place to invest. You know, I mean, it's seen as a place where foreigners are welcome. Are foreigners welcome in this country? Can, I mean, you know, you ask yourself.
I think the most welcome foreigner is the Chinese.
Well, even honestly, there, I mean, look.
The most there accepted.
The most accepted.
Most
and
accepted.
Even then, look, where do the Chinese go for their rest and recreation? They don't go from Lahore to Karachi or, you know, I mean, they go somewhere else for the. So point is, one has to look at the totality of the picture, how hospitable this country is to foreigners, how welcome they are. I mean, it's still very much a security state. And for right reasons, I mean, you know, we are all the time worried that any foreigner moving from Lahore to, let's say, Peshawar is, might get kidnapped and it brings a bad image to the country.
Advisories are issued.
So, having said that, I think with time, hopefully things will improve, you know, with better governance. I think the other thing is, you know, when we earlier talked about the competitiveness and doing business indicator, that's moving in the other direction. Pakistan needs to improve its cost of doing business. Pakistan needs to improve its competitiveness to be able to attract companies to come here. Mm-hmm. I mean, a person.
Sir, once upon a time, we were really great. 70% of our exports were based on textile.
Yeah. Now, the thing is,
interestingly, you know, look, 1 billion worth of towels, I remember, were exported.
This whole
1.2 billion worth of rice was exported.
But Faisal, this whole discussion you had with Miftah about stable exchange rate, it's hurting exports.
He admitted it. He said that is the reason.
But the point is, when all these countries, their exchange rates have devalued and ours has strengthened, right? If India has gone down, that means Indian exporters are much more competitive than Pakistan because they can, you know, their exchange rate has gone down. So the question is, I think even in the IMF and all international agencies are saying that our exchange rate is overvalued by 10 to 15%.
So that means that the dollar should be by 35 rupees a dollar.
So, yeah, whatever it is.
I mean, that's what I'm saying. It could be.
When
like yuan
say,
is, for that matter, yuan is undervalued, around 18 to 20%.
Is undervalued, right?
Yeah, undervalued.
So this package of 180 billion, when Mr. Ismael was saying, okay, we're going to give them a duty drawback, all over the world, exporters work under a zero tax regime.
Yes.
So on the one hand, now what is happening in the last couple of years, they have to pay duties on whatever they import.
They also get rebates.
And they get, but rebates never come because FBR holds on to that money. Look at the amount of refunds that FBR is holding on to. I mean, genuine exporters, they work on very thin margins, right?
And there are so many pending cases, unfortunately, if you just sort those out. I mean, you talk about a huge chunk of money, sir, that could be available.
This 180 billion may be the refund that they are genuinely owned by the FBR. So basically, we may be giving them what they actually belongs to them, right? So all I'm saying is, I think, yes, things have improved, but there's a huge sort of additional actions that need to be taken in terms of ensuring that, you know, our tax system works. Are all the institutions that are there for us, for exporters to export, whether it is the customs or the port authorities or electricity that they work.
Absolutely.
Our electricity right now is perhaps one of the costliest in the region.
It's more expensive than
Vegas. More expensive. It's more expensive
than Las Vegas.
In Las Vegas, it's more expensive than Europe. It's more expensive than your competitors. So no wonder, I mean, our exports are.
So there are a lot of issues. So moving on now. The moment you talk to any government official or anybody else, they talk about CPAC. Oh, that is going to be a game changer. That's what the Prime Minister also says, that it's going to actually benefit 3 to 3.5 billion people. Central Asia, India, I mean, if they want, Pakistan, this entire Chinese population, so on and so forth. And you have really studied about CPAC. Sir, what difference will it make? And I'm talking about, let's say, 10 years from now, 13 years from now. Let's say I'm talking about 2030. What do you see in 2030 if CPAC really takes off well the way the government wants?
First of all, we have to understand the CPAC in the Chinese perspective. What is the background of the CPAC? It is the biggest strategy of China to maintain its growth pace. And there is a theory in China, if you develop your economy in isolation, that is not stable.
Like, as they say, regions grow, individual countries do not grow.
like United States of America has developed a lot, but its neighboring country are still, like Mexico, still poor. So a lot of people migrating from Mexico to United States legally and some illegally. So biggest headache for Americans is the illegal immigration. In China, there are school of thoughts. They believe that we have to grow the whole region. So they have taken initiative One Belt, One Road, Uber concept, that is 65 countries of the region and 6 Silk Routes. One of them is small part of that big strategy is the CPEC. So the Chinese has a designed CPEC in a very well planned manner. It is not only connectivity.
And they've been thinking about it for the last maybe 20 years.
Yes.
If not more, because they've always planned to develop their western side and they were investing billions and billions of dollars at that time, sir.
This is my subject. I have a complete research on this one. I lived in China for many years. I studied in China. I speak the Chinese language just like my Punjabi. I have a lot of social contacts and very deep penetration to Chinese society.
What do they say? Huh? What do they say about this CPEC and everything in Pakistan?
Yes. So I tell you, it is a long background of this CPEC. Mm-hmm. Since 1987, there was a first paper published in China about how to keep the growth of China.
Almost 30 years ago?
30 years ago. And then every year there were conferences and researchers writing paper, discussions, and a lot of debate was going on. Till the new government has owned it, the Xi Jinping government in 2013, owned it, and they give the name One Belt, One Road Initiative.
Okay.
So now the concept is very much mature in China. It's very much mature. They have very well planned this concept. And CPEC is one small branch of that one. CPEC is just not only economic corridor, it is to help Pakistan industrialize also. In agriculture sector, they are willing to help us. So in all over sectors of the economy, they are willing to help us. And they have planned very well. First of all, they want to shift their industry to Pakistan. They notice that in Pakistan, the biggest hurdle to industrialization is power. So they have given 33 billion out of 46 billion for the power generation. So once we overcome the power gap, then the industry will move. So it will be really game changer for this region.
So you believe that in 2030, let's suppose, the GDP would be somewhere around $600 billion to $650 billion?
I think so.
You think Pakistan has that kind of potential? Obviously, and you talk about
Pakistan has this
the
potential.
Population growth, and then you talk about the 5% loss in terms of GDP every year because of the environment issue. There were hardly any rains. In Islamabad, we never felt this way. That we didn't even feel cold this time.
In fact, the Chinese have proposed many other things. Once I was in a meeting in China and they have proposed the government of Pakistan that we are a very unfortunate nation. Twice in a year, we have disaster due to related to water. In the rainy season, we have so much water, it becomes flood. And flood is disaster for Pakistan. After a couple of months...
2010, we lost about $120 billion of clean water that went into the sea. One third of your country was underwater actually.
And
interestingly, whose fault is it that? Is it God's fault, sir? No, sir. It's our own fault.
Yes.
You need to make dams not only to use them as a reservoir, but to also generate cheap electricity.
Just after
priorities
a few months,
need to be sorted out.
Just after a few months, we have the drought season, and there's a shortage of water, and our agriculture has been suffered. Our animals are dying, and no water.
Well, sir, let's not blame the nature for that. I think one has to look inward.
We have to plan.
You have to look.
We have to plan ourselves.
Well, one has to plan. So, but anyway, thank you very much, sir. It was a pleasure, Dr. Saab. And that's all we have for this hour. I'll see you at 8 tomorrow. Till then, you take good care of yourself. Khuda hafiz.
Wages and Shah Chandwali Gate is named.